thanks a lot for this opportunity to talk to you. This is, came up by chance as one of the keynote speakers for this week canceled 10 days before the start of the conference. And so I jumped in and we decided that I go for this lecture. And I named it, Breath, the Universal Key, because, you know, that's what we are looking for, one key that locks up everything, because we need just a few of them, and when we lose a key, then we have another one that can lock everything. The disadvantage, of course, is that when several people have this key, then it would compromise our safety. Anyway, breath at least has as many aspects as the universe has atoms or vibrations. So, where I'm coming from tonight is from a systemic approach. So, I call it also integrative or integral, as an inclusive view upon the world of breath. So I'm not presenting or comparing a lot of schools or methods, because that's another task. It's not what I want to do tonight. I want to show you several breathing techniques, or we can explore them together, but we come from this systemic consciousness where there is not one single approach which makes it happen for everyone and which is the best of all, and all the others are just leftovers from other sources way back. Appreciating and including linear scientific research, where there's a lot of things happened in the last 10 or 15 years in this area, and also including subjectively experiential methods, like they are based on what people experience. And many people in science might say this is not valid, it's not interesting, we cannot do something with that, but that experience is valuable for the person experiencing it. So it has to have a place in the world of knowledge and in the world of consciousness and even in the world of science. So in my view, what's wrong about that is not the subjectivity, but the limited frame of science. And so we can include them in one integral theoretical cognitive model, which is, as I said, inclusive and not exclusive. And when we apply those methods, we go the other way. We apply them individualized and not generalized. So we don't say, person A, you have to fit to my method. And when you don't fit to my method, I make you fit to my method, and then it will work. Rather, we look at the person and see what is the specific state of this person, what is the history, the background, the special traumatization, and the ability of this person to react to certain approaches or offers we make to this person. So this is at least the way I work with clients, and my clients like it. And so they come. So we start with first key. I have several, but not. It's also not encompassing them all. I just use a few of them, so you get an idea, and you have. All of you have a lot more keys than I have, so be proud of yourself. A key to our nervous system is easy to find by this strange term, respiratory sinus think sinus arrhythmia, I don't know how to spell it, but not. The phenomenon itself is a lot easier to understand than the verb to pronounce. It just means, and I think we have already covered that in your lecture, or not, or in people's lecture, breathing in accelerates the heartbeat, breathing out decelerates the heartbeat. So when we breathe in, you could maybe feel the rise in frequency of the heartbeat, and when you breathe out, the heartbeat decreases, which is easy to understand because with in-breath we need some muscular activity. Muscular activity means the contraction of our diaphragm, basically, and of other breathing muscles. And contraction is muscle work and needs energy. Energy is produced by oxygen. So the heart needs to beat faster to provide the oxygen to those cells involved in our breathing. And when we are good breathers, we relax on the exhale. Not when you speak like me. I'm in constant stress, so but I have to do this now for an hour or so. So, but when you're sitting there, you can relax your breathing. That just means that you let go of any activity, any muscular activity, and so the heartbeat goes down. And usually, or when you breathe in a relaxed way, this gives a nice sinus wave. So, and at the same time, let me see if this comes on. Yeah, at the same time, it balances our nervous system because the sympathicus is activated with the in-breathing and the parasympathicus is activated with the relaxed exhale. So we have sympathetic nervous system, parasympathetic nervous in a good balance when breathing is running fine. Plus, what was found out in, especially in coherence breathing, which was founded by Stephen Elliott around 12 years ago, is that with the in-breath, not only air flows in, but also there's an attraction, which is based on the physical components of negative pressure. Blood is drawn to the lungs from the venous part of our circulatory system, and with the exhalation, the opposite happens. The blood flows out the lungs into the periphery and organs of the body. So we have, with the in-breath, we also draw blood to our lungs. With the out-breath, we spread blood out throughout the body. Just take yourself a few breaths and just imagine you breathe slowly in and imagine blood is flowing into the lungs, and you breathe out, blood is flowing out throughout the whole of the body. We often say when we teach breathing, breathe the energy in and spread it in your body. It's just the circulatory system that does this for us. And for this to happen, we need to breathe with our diaphragm. Because our diaphragm is the largest breathing muscle, and its purpose is regulating and giving the motoric impulses for breathing. So this thoracic pump, this thorax pump, only happens when we use our diaphragm, when we just breathe up here. No circulatory effect will happen. And this including also moves, as you know, the abdomen, all the organs in our digestive system, in the belly, are moved by the diaphragm in a rhythmical and smooth, relaxed way. And the lymphatic system is a quite passive system, but it also has to flow, and the only thing that keeps the lymphatic system flowing is the breathing respiratory system. And there's also a connection to the cerebrospinal fluid, which helps to cleanse our brain, because with also in this rhythm, with the exhalation, all the debris and all the litter is taken away from our brain. So when we breathe in this relaxed way, we also cleanse our brain. And this helps our brain to stay healthy, because it doesn't have any leftovers and can start to work in a fresh and new way. And here we are in coherent breathing. I just give you a short outline and we'll do some practice together. More in detail, we could cover that in a workshop I offer tomorrow afternoon. And of course, you can read my book on this subject. So, the essence of coherent breathing is that it's simple to teach, simple to practice. So you don't need a big setup for that. You can do it anytime, anywhere. And the general guidelines are rather short. So you breathe in a rhythm between 3 and 6 respirations per minute, 6 breaths per minute, maximum or the lowest. The slowest rhythm would be 3 respirations per minute. And you have the same length with in and exhale, and you don't make a pause. Because you want to have the same time for the blood to flow into the lungs, at the same time for the blood to flow out of the lungs. Otherwise, your circulatory system would have problems. You use a middle depth of breath, so you don't breathe extremely deep, like you breathe, you also don't breathe shallow, but you use a middle depth, which you can find out by yourself, and you will see that it includes the diaphragm in a soft, but not in a overactive way. You breathe through the nose, because there's no need to breathe through the mouth, and whenever there's no need to breathe through the mouth, nose breathing is recommended due to reasons I will come back later. And what is important, you focus on a relaxed exhale. You focus on letting go on the exhale. And just imagine that you don't need any muscle activity. Like when you lift the arm, you just drop the arm. There's no activity, no energy needed for that. From practice, we know that this even simple method needs adjustment when you work with an individual. So some people have difficulties with relaxing the exhale, some people don't find their rhythm, or some people, for instance, have problems with breathing with 6 breaths per minute, because the average breathing in society, which doctors deem as normal, is between 11 and 13 breaths per minute. In terms of coherent breathing, this is a sign of chronic stress. And you can measure this in the heart rate variability quite easily, because the phenomenon of sinus arrhythmia fades away when you breathe in the quick way. Okay. So the effect, it increases heart rate variability, which can be measured. The Wolfgang just demonstrates in person. He's just measuring his. So, good. Okay. Good value. It aligns breath and heart, so it's beneficial for our heart, as our heart comes in a good rhythm and also in a good variability. So it stays flexible. In the 80s of last century, cardiologists were of the opinion that a good heart beats like a metronome. Pum, 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 pum. Nowadays we know that a heart pumping like that gives you only a few days to go on living. As the Chinese said, you know, when your heart pumps like a bird that a peacock, no, what is it called? Woodpecker, then you have 4 days to live. That's knowledge. 2,000 years old. It aligns breathing and blood circulation, this I already explained, and balances the nervous system, sympathicus, parasympathicus. And what most people need in our society is they have an overactive sympathetic system, they need to strengthen their parasympathetic system. And it's regulating the brain fluid, I also explained that. And in general, it creates coherence in the body. Coherence meaning the alignment of frequencies in our body. So the physical term of coherence says that waves are not the same, but they are in alignment, in a shared flow. So this is what we do here, you know, we are not the same, but we share rhythms, we share vibrations, we share looks, we share our hearts, we share ourselves. And creating common and shared rhythms. So, it's a bit about heart rate variability. It's a huge field, very interesting field when you start to explore it, but it doesn't have to be the general knowledge of breath workers. Yet we know now from all this research that has been done. So, here you have an example of heart rate variability. That means the difference between the peaks of the heart are different in time. So here you have a larger difference, then it's smaller, then it's larger, and then it's smaller. This indicates the heartbeat is variable. And this means the heart is able to adjust to different needs. So it is as if the heart also trains itself in being flexible in reaction to different needs of present situations. Now, a low heart rate variability indicates a weak vagal tone. Vagus is the nerve which is carrying the parasympathetic nervous system. I come to that later. And people with this have a higher vulnerability to post-traumatic stress disorder. There are many studies. They measured people who went to war, and when they came back, those who had before a lower HRV then also had higher symptoms of traumatic stress disorders. It's also common for depression, heart diseases, chronic inflammation. For instance, when you have sepsis, the first thing that happens is that HRV drops. Also, you wouldn't notice any symptoms in your body. And there is a lot of other examples for that. Whereas a higher HRV or healthy vagal tone indicates lower biomarkers for stress, increased psychological and physical resilience, that means the ability to cope with stress, better cognitive function, better autonomic sympathovagal modulation, reducing the stress-related cardiovascular response in three hypertensive students. This also was a study. I don't go into that now because we have a lot to cover today. And also leads to better regulation of glucose level in the blood so that the risk of diabetes, stroke, and cardiovascular diseases is reduced. So good benefits. I come now to a more general field, which I think is crucial for our adaptability and also for our survival, not only as individuals, but also as a species. So this is the key to flexibility. Flexibility, by this I mean not a specific ability, but like a general ability. So to react to situations, we sometimes say spontaneously, not in a prefixed way, or not in a habitual way. You remember Peter's lecture, it was a lot about habits, fixed ways of reacting to reality. That means a lack of flexibility. And what we do when we work with clients basically is we increase their flexibility, not to react to challenges in life in always the same way, again and again, like creating the same miseries again and again, but trying other ways of coping with reality. Like walking differently, or acting differently, walking differently. On the physiological level, this means freedom for our bodies to function in a more flowing mode and not in a rigid mode. To come out of conditioning that had their sense in situations which were traumatic in our lives. When we suffer some traumatization, then we create rigid patterns in our bodies. You know, every body worker knows, there is a tension here in the body, and there is a trauma. Especially the trauma muscles, the psoas muscles, as those people who do trauma release exercises can show you. So we have the adaptability in a faster changing environment. We know that our world, that the speed of changes globally and locally increases. So we have more and more changes, we have to adapt more and more. But with a rigid nervous system, it's hard to cope with that. And that many people then sit and say, it's all, everything is changing, and what should I do? I cannot cope with this society. So much things have changed. And so they go home and turn on their TV and increase their inflexibility. So it has a systemic quality to it, because with flexibility we get the ability to take different standpoints, look differently at the world, and ourselves. It's anti-aging because aging processes are due to habitualizing, are due to conditioning, which gets stronger and stronger and limit our ability to move. The more you sit in front of your TV or your computer, sitting, the heavier you get, and the less mobile your body gets. So it's no wonder that you lose all your mobility after some time. And you feel older, tired, depressed, and life doesn't have any sense anymore. Yes, the music of breath, now the secret of music is its flexibility. You never can expect what comes next. And the better music is, the more surprising it is. You know, for instance, Mozart was a genius in creating flexible music. Many composers of his time composed the music where you could expect the next phrase to happen. But Mozart is always good for a surprise. I don't know how he came to this. It's a key to our immune system. No, this is also an interesting finding, which was recently published by some researchers in Vienna. When we are born, our first breath changes our immune systems and our lives dramatically. The sudden expansion that happens releases cytokines, we have heard about this family already in this lecture. And these are good, need a balance between fighting toxins and overreacting. So the body of the baby gets adjusted to these new challenges in the world. Okay, so we come to our vagus. Our vagus should be our best friend because it's available to access our body and to align our inner energies. The vagus is the wandering nerve, as it was called by the ancient doctors. And the vagal tonus, as we already mentioned, means parasympathetic strength. The vagus controls inflammations and also is activated when we exhale in a relaxed way. So our immune system, when we have an excess of cytokines, too much of them, then autoimmune diseases start to happen, which is a kind of a department, a section of diseases which is growing and growing. I mean, maybe the diseases of our age. And we see that intense breathing, as it was measured in the Wim Hof method, reduces cytokines, so that the hope is that with breathing like that, autoimmune diseases can be cured. But also, interestingly, breathe relaxation. Leads to a reduction of cytokines. Here see these nice guys in travel around our bodies. Yeah. So also one interesting subject to me, or one key subject, stress regulation by understanding through stress and de-stress. I'll give you an example, which I thank my nephew who sent me the link. There's a study, US study, which was done with 30,000 33,000 people. Yeah, they were monitored 8 years. They asked them at the beginning, how much stress did you have last year? Much, medium, little. Second question, do you think that stress is harmful for your health? Yes, no. Then they looked at the death records of these people. Of course, people with a lot of stress had a 43% increase risk of dying, but only when they thought that stress is harmful for their health. Those who thought that stress does not harm their health had even better outcome than those who said they had little stress. And the researchers then calculated that 180,000 US persons died prematurely, not from cardiovascular diseases or murder, what's also common there, but and also not from stress, but from their thinking about stress. And this brings us to also what we have discussed on Monday night, the importance of focus. Where do you put your focus? And this has to do with the difference between eustress and distress. So this is not an objective thing, but a subjective feeling. In what context do I put my experience in the moment? When I put it in a framework of this is threatening me, this is doing me harm, I get in danger, somebody wants to kill me, or somebody wants to be mean to me, then the stress becomes a burden, also for our nervous system. And the danger is that this reaction then becomes chronic. And that, I think, is the basic root of suffering people have in our societies. Whereas when you say, okay, I'm late for the train, so I run and I have fun and I take it easy and train my fitness, and then this is a good experience for me and for my inner system, because it could also be shown in other studies that the blood vessels don't constrict in such experiences, but they expand when we are in this positive stress context, as opposed to when we are in a danger situation. So the content, or the context, determines the stress reaction, even on the physiological level. And this indicates that when we do intense breathing practice, we learn stress management, and the same is true with relaxed breathing practice. And so we can adjust what we need for ourselves, intense breathing, and then we relax deeper, because we do it in a safe context. Or we do relaxed breathing and meditate and regulate our stress by that. So hopefully we all move into this area of eustress. I really admire your patience, because it's hard. I really admire your concentration on all the stuff I'm presenting. Eustress, yes, yes. Just relax into this situation. Yes. EU is the Greek for good. Yeah, the Greeks say ευχαριστώ when they say thank you. This is also EU. So it's good, some good health or something. So I have model of five states of the autonomic nervous system. And it differentiates between states of growth, where we feel safe, and states of protection, where we are in a situation of danger or experience ourselves or name this as a danger. And this is, by the way, to also know it is an adaptation of the polyvagal theory, which was founded by Stephen Porges. In this state, we have our best abilities in socializing, verbal communication, cooperation. We are creative and problem solving. The activity of our ventral, this is our new vagal system, because our vagal system consists of an old one, which we have in common also with crocodiles, and the new one, which we have in common with animals like monkeys, mammals, right? Yeah. All the mammals need a ventral, a smart vagal system, which is able to create bonding. And then when we come into the sympathetic area, we have this side of eustress. So we can enjoy excitement, joyful sexual arousal, physical activity, playful competition, like when we play football, as our offer tonight for our fun. But it can happen that it switches over to the fight-flight reaction. When we tend to lose a football game, then we get maybe fearful, aggressive, or come into this fight-flight reaction. And then the lowest or the oldest way of reaction that our nervous system is capable of is the parasympathetic, the old parasympathetic functioning with regeneration, relaxed form of intimacy. We also get in meditation in these states and for sleep. On the trauma side, this is also the chain of trauma stages. It's the lowest stage, which has to do with freezing, helplessness, dissociation, depersonalization, etc. I think I go over that. We need to cover more nasal breathing. No. This you know already. You know, maybe also know that the lungs produce red blood cells, which is not so common knowledge, but it shows the multifunctionality. And we can guess that with good breathing, we also improve this ability of our lungs to produce more red blood cells. Also the nitrogenic oxide story was mentioned on previous lectures, that through nasal breathing we produce nitrogen oxide, and this is so helpful in our body. So as bad it's for our environment, so it's one of the toxins in which are in our environment on hot days like that. The more helpful it is inside our bodies, because it fights inflammation and dilates our vessels. So hormones. Yes. Okay, more hormones. So here you see that sleep disordered breathing. People have a bad sleep because of their habits of breath interruption, and that some hormones protect from them and others have the opposite, promote them. We have hormones which stimulate breathing, and we have other hormones which depress breathing, like dopamine, for instance. And we have acetylcholine. I put a picture here of it because I like it for some reason, because also the vagus hormone, it modulates the parasympathetic nervous system and the heart. Okay, let's do a breathing exercise together. Some oxytocin breathing. Why not? Oxytocin is a nice hormone.
Yes.
You all like it. Just one downside you should be aware of. It creates a group egotism. But in general, it's of good use. Anyway, we put our hands to our heart. Breathe in softly and breathe out with a like there is no reason to stop that exercise. It's the end for the rest of your life. At least for me it felt like I have to make a violent disruption. Oxytocin. So you can practice whenever you feel need for more oxytocin. Dopamine breathing. We have a piece of music. Dopamine, it's called dopamine breathing, just experience it. So notice the difference. Different energy of dopamine. Imagine that psychotherapy can be done otherwise. could be done in another way. Trust, oxytocin, we had already, self-esteem, dopamine, good mood, serotonin. I skipped the serotonin exercise, sorry, because okay, so we do. I have to be flexible. So, this is done with serotonin breathing, with breathing in through the nose, breathing out through the mouth. Plus, in breath with the tongue up, and out breath with the tongue to the floor of the mouth. Plus, we put the left hand here, and the right hand to the side of the head. So we do 4 deep breaths. Inhaling through the, if you say it again, inhaling through the nose, tongue is up, and outhaling, exhaling, tongue to the floor. Now we change and put the right hand to the back side of the head. Again, 4 breaths in the same way. Breathing in through the nose, tongue out. Out breath through the mouth, tongue down. Now we change hands and put the right hand to the right side of the chest and the left hand to the left hand, left side of the body. Again, 4 breaths. Last circle, we put the left hand on the forehead so that the fingers bend to the top of the head. 4 deep breaths. So now you should have a nice cocktail of serotonin, dopamine, and oxytocin. What's the effect of a dry lecture like that? There's now a section about key to sustainable health. So how can we keep a society which is healthy and not has diseases, new diseases, old diseases, and a lot of suffering. And a lot of money goes into that, which we miss in education, science research, in funding, breathwork, etc. 25% of social expenditure goes into the health system, which is roughly 10% of the GNP in European countries. And it's growing per year by 4%. And what we want to teach with breath awareness is self-responsibility for one's health. So health is not the concern and the obligation of the system, but it's also our own concern. We are responsible for our health. And this we do by repossessing our body, by taking back our body, which to some extent we gave off to the system, like we work in systems which ignore or violate the needs of our bodies, or we go to the health system which takes care of our body, like the auto mechanic takes care of our motor. The next, for me, really exciting thing is about placebo. That means nothing. When we do breath work, people feel relieved, or they feel more stressed, or they feel something. All the positive effects we have by breathing consciously, they can have various and different causes. We don't exactly know what is the cause of a result we have. And this has been found out in all the placebo studies which have been done over the years. Remember, the most famous, I think, is the one where they did knee operations with patients. And they had the same results whether they just made a simple cut or whether they made a real operation. So it turned out that you don't even need to operate and cut all the things out that are not working anymore. The body heals itself because it believes it has been operated. But the other thing is that all these placebo effects, none of them is 100%. Also all the healing effects in traditional medicine, in alternative medicine, in ghost healing, in spiritual healing, nowhere there's 100%. Otherwise everybody would be there. So this also regulating the whole system. So all beneficial effects, we do any kind of therapy. We think it might be because we use this one method and not the other, but we don't know. Can we just be a placebo effect? Because the person likes the room, or the person relaxes on the way because there are nice trees outside, or something, or they like the color of our shirt or something. I changed the shirt and So there's always exceptions to a rule. There's no rule, there's no absolute truth in this whole field. So we have to let go of any beliefs around that, because it just creates rigidity again. You know, in psychotherapy research, they found one factor which is crucial for healing, and this is personal relationship. And this personal relationship is unique with every client. There's nothing common. You also cannot learn this from books. You just can learn this from inner experience, from going deeper inside of yourself. So we come to the, or at least I come to the idea that therapy is a kind of art, not a kind of technique or something like that. It's more related to that area. Okay. First and third person. This means when we have a problem, there's a third person telling us what the cause of the problem is and what the remedy is. What we have to get to is that we have an interaction between first person approach. Like, I feel this and that, and I have, because I'm the expert for my body, I'm the expert for my life, I know basically what's wrong and what's right. But often I need somebody from outside to tell me, to look at points which I cannot see. but also this person relies on me and my inner knowledge. So what we want to aim at when we do breath work, when we bring people to breathe consciously, gain more self-sense, inner sense, self-knowledge, self-experience, self-awareness. And this combination then works best for healing in different areas. We include also second person, third person, first person, plural, third person, plural. I don't go into this because this is a whole other field, like creating a society where self-awareness is a key point also for people in society. A key to beauty. Breathing is a form of harmony we experience. This is a nice image of a sinusoidal rhythm, and we like this. You know, it's just nice to see. That's like the basic form of beauty we experience with a smooth and relaxed breathing rhythm. Sense of flow, sense of form, all included. So we come to the key to music. First rhythm. So we make an experiment. So we start with a breathing rhythm, which is designed to bring you into trance. 2 times inhalation and 1 exhale through the mouth. Inhaling through the nose. Now we give more accent. Breathe on. We will rock you. Rock you. We will rock you. We will rock you. Has to do with diaphragm. Singing is diaphragm. Playing a wind instrument is diaphragm. When it comes to that. Humming, creating also nitrogen oxide. Very healthy thing to do. That's humming. time is over. I just give you an overview of things you already know. Speak to silence. The school of Isenmittendorf, which wanted to have the place originally. We had someone from Germany presenting the school of perceptive breath, founded by Isenmittendorf, famous breathwork teacher, almost 100 years old and died some 5 or 10 years ago. And her basic sentence is, let the breath come by itself, let it go by itself, and wait till the new in-breath comes by itself. But having this relaxed and awareness of the breathing. So in awareness you look at the silence between the breaths. You know, one sentence came to me this week having to do with silence. Out of infinite silence we come, and to infinite silence we return. Having this short period of sound, listening, feeling, and feeling in this inner connectedness. So, come to an end, and I really thank you for your patience. Thank you.
Talk and discuss about them in private.